Page 26 in your manual, okay? And, all right. Isaac, would you like to pray? Please. Okay, fine. I wanted to change it because every time we ask you to pray before food, so I said we'll ask for the class. Okay, so yeah, let's go. Amen. Okay, so page 26 in your manual, and that's the introduction to the book of Ruth, the point of light in a dark night. Okay, we remember we spoke on the book of Judges, and we closed with saying in those days there was no king in Israel. Now, everyone did what was right in their own sight. The book of Ruth is the time frame is the same during the book of Judges. It's in the middle of the book of Judges, time wise, historically wise, that this events happened. Okay, so it's in that dark period of history of Israel, you could see what God was still doing. Okay, and that speaks about the work of God, that no matter how dark it seems, God is doing something behind the scenes. So the work of God is always going on. Okay, so this part of page number 26 historical literally features all that you go through. Okay, and we reach page 28 now. Suggest that when I'm teaching going through the chapters, make sure you are on the same page in your manual and you're taking notes next to it. Okay, sometimes people are taking the notes of book of Judges and they're still in the writing on the side of next to book of Joshua. You will never get it when you try to study it. You'll keep going back and forward. So when I'm talking about chapter numbers, see where you are on the page and then write notes next to it. Okay? If you don't write, no problem. Entirely up to you. But it'll help you. Okay? So, here we go. Book of Ruth. Chapter 1 and verse 1. Now it came about in the days when the judges governed. So that's how you find out and where this book was being written. When the days when the judges were governing. Which one we do not know, but it's mentioned there. It is happening during the time of the judges. There was famine in the land. Now remember in the Old Testament, whenever you see famine in the land, it means it's the judgment of God. Famine in the Old Testament always speaks about the judgment of God. So there was judgment on the land. Okay, it's going around that time. Okay. And a certain man of Bethlehem in Judah went to sojourn in the land of Moab with his wife and his two sons. Now, does this remind you of something? There is a famine and they leave the house and they go somewhere else. Abraham. There is famine. Okay, let's go to Egypt. What does Egypt speak of? The world. Here, where is this certain man? In Bethlehem. And when the famine comes, where does he decide to go? Moab. Okay, now there is a beautiful word picture here. If you see the word, the names in the Hebrew language, it brings a nice picture. Bethlehem means house of bread. Okay, Moab means waste or garbage can. Okay, Bethlehem, house of bread. Moab means either waste or it's a garbage can. So when the famine came, instead of walking by faith, this certain man chose to walk by sight. Exactly what Abraham had done many years ago. Okay? So, and it's a principle that we always realize. It's like, no matter what your circumstances are, situations are, unless God tells you to move, don't move. Unless you have a clear understanding of what God is saying and He's asking you to move, don't move. Maybe you are placed in that situation, that test is there for your promotion. It could be there for your promotion, that you go through it by faith and then God will promote you. But if you run away from it, you lose what God had planned for you. Okay, and you will see that this man goes away from the place he's supposed to be in and never comes back. They thought they will sojourn there, means go for a little while and come back to get rid of the famine, but they don't come back. They die in that place. They lived there for 10 years. They went there and they lived there. And sometimes it also speaks about the Christian life. If you think you can go back and live like a worldly person, then come back and live like a worldly person, the world's attractions are too great for you or any Christian to think that we can manage both. It does not work. Okay? It does not work. So, what does Elimelech, the name of the man was Elimelech. Okay? Elimelech means God is my king. And the name of his wife was Naomi. Naomi means pleasure. So man of God, God is my king, married pleasure. That's fun. And he got two children, Mahlon and Chilion. Mahlon means sickness, Chilion means wasting away. So God is my king, saying I'll marry pleasure. He says, okay, you got two gifts, sickness and wasting away. So, you don't have to write it down, but this is for your knowledge, but this we're going to go move forward, okay? And it says there, they entered the land of Moab and then what? Remained there. Big mistake. They entered the land and they remained there. Cause of unbelief, okay? They did not trust God in the land of Bethlehem. It is known as house of bread, which means God would provide for his people there, right? But they did not trust God in those times. So, unbelief, okay? In Job chapter 9 verse 4, it says, who has hardened himself against the Lord and prospered? Who thinks that he can do what he wants and go against the Lord and think it'll prosper? Doesn't work, right? And Job in that verse answers this question. Nobody. Nobody will. Okay? So, there is a famine. Okay? Now, where do you find that famine is like a discipline from God? Leviticus 26 will give you the answer there. Okay, so you can see there Leviticus 26, also in Deuteronomy chapter 28. Okay, why? Because what was happening during the time of Judges? People were turning away and worshipping idols. So God was sending a famine or was judging them. Okay, right? So, wrong decision taken, walking by sight, not by faith. Then he took for himself Moabite women as wives. Now, is he supposed to take that as happen? Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died and she was left with her two sons, and their sons took themselves Moabite women as their wives. Were they allowed to marry people outside? No. You see how it progresses? So, the name of one was Orpah, the name of the other was Ruth. Orpah means double-minded. Ruth means beauty or something worth seeing. Okay? Orpah means double-minded. Ruth means beauty or grace or something worth seeing. Okay? Now, this beautiful word picture there. We'll talk about that later. Okay? So, Boaz means in him is strength. And the name of the other was Ruth, and they lived there about 10 years. Then both Mahlon and Chilion also died, and the women bereft of her two children and her husband. Okay, so we can very clearly see, right, that they, instead of walking by faith, they walked by sight. Then they entered and they did what they were not supposed to do. They were going against the command of God. They leave the house of God, they leave those things, and they are happy with the world, thinking that the world will provide for them spiritual death. All three of them could not come back into the land. It's a way the book of Ruth begins with, you know, three funerals in a way. Three people dying. And the reason why they died was because they left the house of worship. They left the house where they were supposed to be and they went into the world and thought that they'll be okay there. It doesn't work. The place where God has placed you, He's placed you for a plan and a purpose, right? If you run away from God's test, you will miss out on the blessing. It's as simple as that. And in the test, in the trial, walk by faith and you will experience God's blessing. Okay, God can provide for you anywhere. Anywhere, right? If He can feed Elijah through the ravens, He can do anything, right? He can do anything, right? So, it's also very, very immediately we begin to see the how the work of faith is. Then she arose with the daughter-in-laws that she might return from the land of Moab, for she had heard that in the land of Moab that the Lord had visited his people in giving them food. So now she wants to go back to Bethlehem. Why? The Lord is giving food. Not because of the Lord is giving food. So the Bethlehem has become prosperous again. Wrong motivation in going back. She didn't have the proper motivation in going back, right? So, actually write these few verses down. This is Acts 17:28, Psalms 37:25, Acts 20:24, and Matthew 6:33. Okay? Matthew 6:33. Now, how did Moab come into existence? How did Moab come into existence? Through Lot. Wrong relationship of Lot. Moab came in, right? They were always against. They were 50 miles away from in Bethlehem. They were not very far. It was the Moabites who seduced the Israelites into sinning in the book of Numbers. They were always against. God did not want them there. But we'll see a picture during that time. Okay, so you can read that in Numbers 22. Okay, now Elimelech dies, Mahlon dies, Chilion dies, and now they are wanting to go back. So here is on their way back, and she wants to go back because the Lord is blessing. So let's go back. Now, when you see that, so she departed from the place where she was, and her two daughter-in-laws with her, and they went their way to the Judah. And Naomi said to her two daughter-in-laws, "Go and return to your mother's house. And may the Lord deal with you as you have dealt with the dead and with me." Why is she not wanting them to come back to Bethlehem and wanting them to go remain in Moab? But they are who now? They are married into the family. So why is she not wanting them to come back to Bethlehem with her? She's going back to her home. Why is she wanting them to stay back? You know why? I have lived a worldly life. I'm going back with Moabites. People may point fingers at me. Your husband died because you went to Moab. Your children died because they married Moab. She was concerned about her reputation. Don't come. But if she had taken them there, wouldn't they got saved? Wouldn't they become like, in a sense, like become like what God was wanting to do in their lives? But she was more concerned about, why? What was the motivation? The Lord is giving food, let me go back. It's not that the Lord I want to visit, I want to visit his provision. Right? When we don't want God and we want only his blessing, well, you know, you're going to get a few disappointments. I want what God is giving, but I don't want God. Whatever he provides, it's good with me, but God, yeah, I can talk to him later. Never satisfaction. There is always a disappointment, right? So, so in a way you can say that her decision is correct, but her motive is wrong. And verse 9, "May the Lord grant you may find rest, each in the house of her husband." And then she kissed them and lifted up their voices and wept. And they said to her, "No, we will surely return with you to your people." Now, Naomi said, "Return, my daughters, why should you go with me? Have I yet sons in my womb that they may be your husbands? Return, my daughters, go, for I am too old to have a husband. I said, if I have a hope, I should ever have a husband tonight. Would you therefore wait until they are grown? Would you refrain from marrying?" Now, she's talking about the Hebrew culture right there, but basically she doesn't want her two daughter-in-laws to come with her. Right? Going back to Moab, would it mean that they would go back and worship their false gods? Of course. Yeah. Instead of getting them to Bethlehem, she's telling them to go back and worship their false god. Bad testimony, right? She is trying to cover up her disobedience by not taking them with her, right? So, in verse 14, "They lifted up their voices and wept again. And Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clung to her." What it means there is, Orpah kissed her and then said, "Okay, bye, I'm going. I need a husband. See you. Thank you for giving me permission. I'll be happy where I am." Kissed and going back. right, kissed and going back. But Ruth clung to her and said, behold, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and her gods. Return after your sister-in-law. Okay. Naomi is trying to cover up. Orpah actually gave up. Ruth is saying, I'm not giving up. I'm going with you. Verse 16. Do not urge me to leave you or turn back from following you. For where you go, I will go. Where you stay, I will stay. Your people shall be my people. And that's where the salvation comes in. Your God is my God. Your God is my God. Right? She's already made a decision in her mind. Right? She's, instead of being an example, Naomi had to learn from Ruth now. Okay? And Naomi is a picture of a backslidden believer. Right? Backslidden believer. Okay, and then when she saw that she was determined to go with her, she said to her, no more. Okay, someone's convicting her right now. Arrival in Bethlehem. So they both went until they came to Bethlehem, and it came about when they had come to Bethlehem that the city stirred them up. Said, is this Naomi? Okay? And she called them and said, do not call me Naomi, call me Mara. Mara means bitterness. Okay? From pleasant, she says, call me bitterness, for the Almighty has dealt very bitterly with me. Did the Almighty deal very bitterly with her? Isn't it when people get bitter, first blame God, then blame others, but no blame self. When people get bitter, God, you did this to me, and these people, and look at me. I went out full, but the Lord brought me back empty. Thank you very much for giving credit to the Lord. Who told you to go? Right? Who told you to go? So why do you call me Naomi? So the Lord has witnessed against me. You know what the word Lord there is? El Shaddai, the Almighty God. She's not using any other word. She's calling him the Almighty One who can do any, for whom nothing is impossible. And she says, he has done this to me. Backslidden believer, he has done this to me. You made the mistake. And now you're upset with God because what God is doing, right? So, I went out full, but the Lord brought me back empty. Thank you very much. What a testimony. She's covering up her disobedience. That's what she's doing. She's trying to justify what she did. And that's what we do when we disobey God and go against His will. People's first reaction is always to justify. And then, of course, blame God, right? So, He's not around, right? So, I can blame Him. I can do whatever, you know, who will know? Right? God did this to me. But I'm happy that He did this to me. Hyper-spiritual backslider. She has experienced trials, disappointments, but she's blaming God, right? If she had trusted and the family had trusted God in the first place, this situation would have never happened. Right? So, I went out full and I came back empty. The Lord has, Almighty has afflicted me. So, Naomi returned with her daughter, with Ruth the Moabitess, her daughter-in-law, who returned from the land of Moab. And they came to Bethlehem at the beginning of the barley harvest. Right? So, the key verses in this chapter would be verse 16 and verse 17. Okay? Verse 16 and verse 17. Micah chapter 7 verse 18. Titus chapter 3 verse 5. Okay. Micah 7:18. Titus chapter 3 verse 5 speaks about the mercy of God. Those two are very key verses. People should, like Naomi, should have been thinking about God's mercy that she was still alive rather than blaming Him. Okay. So Micah 7:18 and Titus chapter 3 verse 5. Okay, and remember Ruth 1, 16 and 17. Okay. By the way, you see Ruth in the line genealogy of Jesus Christ, remember? The Jews were what? When they would make a genealogy, they were more interested in the man, in the father, in the line. They were more interested in the line that comes down and it comes from the father. Ancestry. They wanted to know, was it from the line of Abraham and all these things. It's very strange, or I wouldn't say strange, but I think it's a grace of God that they put five names of women there in their genealogy. And those five are who? Tamar, Rahab, Ruth, Bathsheba, and Mary. Right? Now, what are their backgrounds? You look at their backgrounds. What was Tamar's background, right? She committed incest with her father-in-law. What was Rahab, right? Harlot. Ruth, Moabite. God had said, stay away from them. Bathsheba, adulteress. Mary, virgin found with a child. And it's the grace of God that you see all those pictures right there. That why would they be included in the genealogy of Jesus Christ? And it was just to show how what the grace of God can do with a person. Okay. And by the way, Bathsheba is never referred in the Bible to as David's wife. She's always referred to as the wife of Uriah the Hittite. God did not approve of that. Right? God did not. But in his grace, through Bathsheba came Solomon. So understand that in the worst situation also, God resurrects situations through his grace. But does not mean you can do whatever you feel like. It does not mean that, right? So, going ahead. So, blaming God for trials in verses 19 to 22. And that's the point number C in your on your book. Okay? So, returning to Bethlehem is also, you can write there, blaming God for all the trials. Okay? He has become now bitter. Now, chapter 2. And this is verse 1. Now Naomi had a kinsman of her husband, a man of great wealth, the family of Elimelech, whose name was Boaz. Now why is it saying kinsman? To understand the principle of kinsmen, Leviticus 26. Okay, read Leviticus 26, and I'll talk about that in a while. But and Ruth the Moabitess said to Naomi, please let me go to the field, glean among the ears of the grain after one in whose sight I may find favor. And she said, go, my daughter. Now Israel was given the command. God was, when he gave the laws to Israel, he was very gracious. He knew how to take care of the poor, the widow, the orphans. So when people would harvest from their fields, they were not supposed to cut at the edges of their field, so that the poor, the widows, could come and glean from the fields. Because they did not have any land, they did not have any means to support themselves. So God would tell them, where is it? In the book of Leviticus, go read it. That don't cut the edges, leave that there. So that the people can come and glean. The poor can come and take for themselves. It was a law ordained by God, the way to take care of the poor and the needy, especially the widows and the orphan kids, right? So that's how it would happen. When it was given in Leviticus 26, in the book of Ruth, that's where it's going to get of effect. That law, we see that here, how it's getting affected. Okay? So, Ruth's story begins, right? And then you see in verses 1 to 3. So this is a step of faith on the part of Ruth. Leviticus 19, Leviticus 23, and Deuteronomy 24, you will find these laws. Okay, so read them there. So God tells them how to use that. Okay, so now the problem with Ruth was not only she was a widow, but she was also an alien. She was not from the Jews. She was a Moabitess, right? So even more reason. So she had every right to look to God for her provision. That's why she's asking this question. Okay, it's an act of faith. So she departed and went and gleaned in the field after the reapers, and she happened to come along to the portion of the field belonging to Boaz, who was of the family of Elimelech. Now, remember, in those days, they didn't have markings like you have today. This land belongs to so-and-so that long. It was open, so it was left like this. She did not know where she was going. So it was not by accident that she ends up at Boaz's field. It is God who brings her there. When you read these stories, oh, by acts, no, God led her to the right place. God led her. Because she was in faith, she was saying, let me go. In whose sight? She did not know who was the kinsman. She did not know the one who could bring her back. But God led her to that place. In verse 4, Boaz came, right, from Bethlehem and said to the reapers, may the Lord be with you. And they said to him, may the Lord bless you. And Boaz said to his servants, whose young woman is this? And the servant replied, she is a young Moabite woman who returned with Naomi from the land of Moab. And then she said, please let me glean and gather after the reapers among the sheaves. She came and has remained from morning until now. She has been sitting in the house for a little while. So it's basically, he's the relative, okay? He's the near one. And we'll see in verses... In these verses that are coming up, then Boaz said to Ruth, listen carefully, my daughter. Now, he's not referring to her, my daughter. It's basically a term used for the one who is close. In the Song of Solomon, when the man is addressing his to-be wife, he's calling her my sister. So it does not mean it's a sister. It's a term of close relationship. Okay, so it does not mean that Boaz was telling Ruth, you are my daughter, and then he ends up marrying her. That's not the way. In the Hebrew language, those words are used for those who are near and dear ones, loved ones, closed ones, okay? So that's why they are used for. So chapter 4, we see that, verse 4 onwards, you will see how, as Ruth goes there, and in verse 8, Boaz greets her, right? First he sees her, then he greets her. Now, do you think Boaz knew who Ruth was? Of course he knew who was. Of course he knew who was. Look at verse 11 in chapter 2. All that you have done for your mother-in-law after the death of your husband has been fully reported to me. He knew. He knew who she was. Once they said that this is Ruth, he had not seen, but he had heard about her. How you left your father and your mother and the land of your birth and came to the people that you previously did not know. That's the mission's verse right there. That's the discipleship verse right there. What did Ruth do? Isn't that what we do in a way today, the same way? Who's it called? don't worry about it. So he said, it has been fully reported to me of how you left your father and your mother and the land of your birth and came to the people that you did not previously know. And that's like the verse in verse 11, when you see the word Boaz replied to her, that word replied actually means he raised his voice in excitement. He wanted everyone to know who she was and what she had done. He raised his voice and started speaking loudly in front of everyone. This is what she has done. She has left her father, mother, her country, and she has come. And we have seen what she, and this is basically missions. This is what we are, right? This is what a disciple does. He is not counting the cost. He is not counting his family. He is not counting. The love of God has so constrained him that he is willing to go to another country, another place, and missions, which is not his own place. And he's willing to go there and serve the Lord and be a disciple there and disciple people and win souls. So verse 11 is a very good missions verse. That's the promise that we have. You left your father, mother, right? Didn't Jesus say that in the New Testament? Did Jesus say that he who leaves his father, mother, brother, sister will find what? Hundredfold in this age and in the age to come, right? Hundredfold, right? So missionaries go, they leave their homes, they go plant a church. There they find what? Fathers, mothers. They find them there, right? They find them there. And you see that they're happening, right? You came to a people that you previously did not know. Right? Romans 15:20. We want to go and preach where Jesus is not named. That was Paul's desire. I want to go to places where Christ is not named. Previously did not know. I am going to those places where Christ is not named, right? I think that is Pastor Pradeep Lima's verse that God gave him, right? Romans 15:20, it's right there in his house, big. I want to preach Christ where he's never been previously named. Nobody knows. I want to go in those areas. And that's what God, that was in his heart, and God is using that to do that in his life. Okay, so Ruth, young, eligible woman. Basically, men would have noticed her. Do you think some different men would have noticed her? It's there in chapter 3, verse 10. Okay, we are not saying in the sky, we are saying it because what's in the Bible. Boaz mentions that because Boaz was a little older man, he said, there could have been young men, but you did not go to them, you came to me. Okay, you came to me. Now, when you see all this principle of in this book, in our ministry, this is how we teach. It's the man who initiates to the woman, okay? When it comes to dating or someone wants to get married or they like someone, it's the man who takes the first step. He initiates. Now, if a lady likes someone, she should go to the covering. She should go to a pastor, confide. Okay? Do not approach people directly is what we say in this ministry. It becomes, there's confusion, wrong signals can go out. Why? It is possible that the pastor may know more about the certain individual than you know. So when man takes the initiative, he has to go to his covering. When the woman wants, woman do not take the first step. It sends out a wrong signal. If they do like someone, they should go to the pastor and say, Pastor, I think this is so and so. What do you think? The pastor may know more a little bit, and then he can bring them together, or they can pray about it and then move forward. Okay? Be very careful, be very sensitive. Okay? So it's man initiates, always remain under a covering. Okay, always remain under a covering. Don't short circuit the process, right? And when you look for what? Spiritual maturity. Okay, look for spiritual maturity. That will be the key indicator. Okay, so Ruth, in the sense, Boaz takes the first step. He has heard about her. Now he sees her personally. Okay, when Boaz arrives, Ruth is resting there. He talks to his workers. Okay, and it's like a divine appointment right there. So let your eyes be on the field which they reap. Go after them. Indeed, I've commanded the servants not to touch you. When you are thirsty, go to the water jars, drink from what. He's already giving her indications that he likes her, because that's not what you would do normally with a person. He's showing that he's interested in her. Now in verse 2, what did she say? I may want to go and find grain in the sight of someone whom in whose eyes I find favor. He said, grace, let me go. She walked by faith, divine appointment came. Okay, God brought Boaz right to this place. Right? Live for God, divine appointment. Live for yourself, disappointment. Simple. Simple. Then she fell on her face, bowing down to the ground, and said to him, why have I found favor in your sight that you should take notice of me, since I'm a foreigner? And then the verse 11 comes up. I know your background. May the Lord reward your work, your wages. Be full from the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings you come to seek refuge. Salvation message right there. Okay? You come to the Lord, God of Israel. He brings you what? He comes into his refuge. So, in verse 8, Boaz takes the initiative and he speaks to Ruth. In verses 9, 14 and 16, he promises to protect her. And in verse 10 to 13, he encourages her. Okay? Definitely the guy likes her. No question about it. That's why he's doing all those things. Okay? So, he makes sure that she was satisfied in verse 14 and verse 18. At mealtime, Boaz said to her, come here that you may eat of the bread and dip your piece with the bread of vinegar. She sat beside him as if she was one of the home, from her home. Okay. So, satisfies her. Okay. And then, in verses 17 to 23, he says, in verse 16, he says, you shall purposely pull out for her some grain from the bundles and leave it to me for her glean. Do not rebuke her. He is commanding in verse 15 and 16. He commands them to give a little extra. Give a little extra to Ruth. Okay. She gleaned in the field. Then she beat out what she had gleaned, and it was about an ephah of barley. Now ephah of barley basically means it was enough provision for 1 week for two people to make whatever they had. So that she got more than enough than what she had desired, because Boaz says, go, you know, take, give her a little extra. She took it to her mother-in-law. She saw what was gleaned and took it out and gave Naomi what she had left after she was satisfied. And you look there. Verse 20, Naomi finally begins to use spiritual language. May be blessed of the Lord. So I am bitter, but now she begins to change. Okay. What the picture of that is, live in hope. Okay. Live in hope. Have hope. Right. Now, when you're living and things are not going as the way you want them to be, there are two voices. There is a voice of the world, there is a voice of God. If you listen to what the world has to say, definite discouragement. If you listen to what God has to say, you will surely be encouraged. Discouragement comes how? Bible is closed. When your Bible is closed, discouragement will surely come in. Because you're not hearing the voice of God. And then you begin to hear the voices of the world. When you begin to hear the voices of the world, you get even more discouraged. By the way, discouragement is not anything else. Discouragement is very effective tool of the devil. You lose hope, you get discouraged. That's what he wants. You will never be able to function and walk by faith. You will feel like a loser. You feel like everything is lost. That's what he wants believers to happen. That they would lose their hope, they would lose just encourage means to build up, strengthen. If a believer is not encouraged, not strengthened, he will never be able to walk the walk of faith. It will not happen. People get discouraged and they think something's wrong with them. Sorry, you've just been attacked by the devil and you didn't even know. It's a tool that he uses. We don't even realize this. Most Christians don't even have an idea that that is devil's tool, that he uses discouragement. It's the easiest one to stop a Christian in walking his life of faith. Easiest for him to use. People get discouraged at the smallest things. Don't think it is natural. It is supernatural. Discouragement is not natural. It's not an outcome. It's a weapon of the enemy. He uses it to make you feel low, to lose your confidence in God. So how does discouragement come? Bible is closed. People keep saying, I'm not feeling well, I'm not this, I'm this happening, something is not happening. You know why? Open your Bible, then you'll realize why. You read the promises of God, focus on the promises of God, read the word, spend time in prayer. If you don't, you can be sure of discouragement. Okay? Why is that mentioned so many times in the Bible, of every people who made a difference in the Bible? why are the references of their time alone with God? And why is it that after those times alone with God, they have had greatest victories? It's connected. It's connected. You want a victorious Christian life, you have to be alone with God. You are not alone with God, you won't get those times. It's everyone's choice. Right? It's everyone's choice. So, live in hope. Okay? My Lord has not withdrawn his kindness to the living and to the dead. Verse 21. Then Reuben the Moabite said, furthermore, he said to me, you shall stay close to my servants unless they have finished all the harvest. Naomi said to Ruth, her daughter-in-law, it is good, my daughter, that you go out with his maids so that others do not fall upon you in another field. So she stayed close by the maids of Boaz in order to glean until the end of the barley harvest and the wheat harvest. And she lived with her mother-in-law. Okay, so hope, stay close there. Verse chapter 3. This is Ruth's request and this is suggestions by Naomi given to Ruth, right? So, there is a meeting now that Ruth is going to meet Boaz, and then Naomi says, my daughter, shall I not seek security for you that it may be well with you? She is thinking about how will she get married. Now is not Boaz a kinsman with whose maids you were? Behold, he winnows barley at the threshing floor tonight. Wash yourself, anoint yourself, put on your best clothes and go to the threshing floor, but do not make yourself known to the man until he has finished eating and drinking. It shall be that when he lies down, you shall notice the place where he lies, and you shall go and uncover his feet and lie down, and he will tell you what you shall do. And she said, all that you say, I will do. Now, in the Bible, the picture of washing yourself, cleansing, okay? It speaks of cleansing. Remember, when the priest had to go into the tabernacle, would they wash? They would be defiled. They had to wash themselves even before they go into the presence of God. This speaks of cleansing. Okay, so wash yourself. And for a believer, it speaks, ask for forgiveness before you start. Confessing your sins. Having a clean record between you and God. Right? Having a clean record between you and God. Wash me, right? And We don't want, you know, just be sensitive to this part in life. Don't try to do the work of God and live an unconfessed life at the same time. You know, people live in sin and we all fall into sin. But be quick in your recovery before God, before you go and serve Him. If you have unconfessed sin in life, you will never have power in what you say and what you do. You will never have power in what you say and what you do. That there is a reason why God told people in the Old Testament, wash before you come in and approach God. In the New Testament, the picture of washing means asking for forgiveness for what's happened. And maybe there is sin or anything that has gone wrong. Just go before you approach God. You want to do anything for God. Just go and ask for forgiveness. This is a daily routine. Okay? Routine means do it out of reverence for God, right? Then he says, anoint yourself. She anointed herself, right? We are all anointed. Okay? We are all anointed. Okay? So, why is she saying anoint means? Used fragrant oils. In that context, it means fragrant oils. A bride would always use fragrant oils. Reason being, if somebody was near, it would feel like, oh, nice to be near her. There was fragrance coming out, so nice to be near her. In our picture, we are all anointed. 1 John chapter 2, verse 20, every believer is anointed. Anointed means your Holy Spirit is in you. Okay? in you. But nice to be near you is when you are spirit filled. If you are spirit filled, your life is an aroma unto God. If you are not spirit filled, believer stinks, right? So our life, if we are spirit filled, people have fun. People like to be around us. If we are not spirit filled, it's the other way around. Okay? So anointing. We are all anointed. Okay? So she's getting ready, carrying a spiritual meaning. Let's go forward. Ruth prepared herself. Okay, so she presented herself to her, to him, and she says, All that you say, I will do. In verses 6 to 9, she presents herself. Okay, she submits herself to Boaz. Okay, so she's, people will ask, why did Ruth not wait for Boaz to propose? Basically, she knew that he liked her. She knew. Because he had openly said many things to her. Okay? And so she makes herself, because he's also the nearest. He's not the nearest, but he's a kinsman. He's the one who can take care of her. The nearer kinsman is already there. We'll come to that part. Okay? So, in verses 10 to 14 of chapter 3, he says, may you be blessed of the Lord, my daughter. You have shown your last. Now, reason is why she uncovers his feet is so that he'll wake up and then he'll see her, notice her. You have shown your last kindness to be better than the first by not going after young men, whether poor or rich. Okay, there were other eligible bachelors. Ruth shows that she is not interested in those things. Do not fear. I will do for you whatever you ask. For all my people in the city know that you are a woman of. How did they know? She was living right before God, so people knew. Right? Like sometimes people live right before God, they don't need to blow their own trumpet and say, I am living righteously before God. Others see and they know that someone is living for the Lord. They can make out that the life is being lived for the Lord. Like we don't have to stand up and say, I live for God and I do this. No. Even when you live for God without saying, people know. You don't have to blow the trumpet and say, I am doing this. No, you don't need to, right? Our expectation is from whom? From the Lord, right? So, now it is true, I am a close relative. However, there is a relative closer than I. Remain this night, and when the morning comes, if he redeems you, good, let him redeem you. If he does not wish to redeem you, then I will redeem you as the Lord lives. Lie down this morning. Now, in verse 9, the kinsman redeemer, the word for redeemer is G-O-E-L. Okay, it kinsman redeemer is G-O-E-L means redeemer. Okay, close relative. Okay, now. What are the responsibilities? He has to buy back the family property that changed ownership and marry a childless widow to raise up children in her dead husband's name. That was the thing that they had to do. If someone is in the family, becomes a widow, the nearest relative will buy, in a sense, redeem her, set her free, marry her so that the lineage is preserved and raise up children in the husband's name. So Boaz is the kinsman redeemer, but he says there is one who is closer than I. So the one who is closer will get the first opportunity. If he disagrees, then it's my turn. Okay? So they lay at his feet, give me the cloak, he gives a measure of barley. Okay? Now in chapter 4, Boaz went to the gate, sat down, and behold, the close relative of whom Boaz spoke was passing by. He went to the gate and he's passing by. Accident. No, divine appointment, right at that time. Turn aside, friend. Sit down. And they turn aside. Now, he took 10 men of the elders of the city and said to them, sit down here. So they sat down. Remember, whenever they had to do these kinds of dealings in the Old Testament, they would have witnesses around. So there were 10 elders taken. Okay, protection. They're having in front. Nobody can turn their way back. Nobody can say, you did not tell me. So he has witnesses right there. Then he said to the closest relative, Naomi, who has come back from the land of Moab, has to sell the piece of land which belonged to our brother Elimelech. I thought to inform you, buy it before those who are sitting here, before the elders. If you will redeem it, redeem it. If not, tell me that I may know, for there is no one but you to redeem it, and I am after you. And he said, I will redeem you. Now, what that means is, I will buy the land. I will take care of the family. But then he finds out he has to do something else. He says, on the day you buy the field from the hand of Naomi, you must also acquire Ruth, the Moabite. the widow of the deceased in order to raise up the name of the deceased of his inheritance. Then he said, I cannot redeem it for myself. I would jeopardize my own inheritance. Redeem it for yourself. You may have my right of redemption, for I cannot redeem. Why did he refuse it? My own inheritance. Secondly, it could also be that he must have found Moabite. She was a Moabitess. I don't want her. If children come through her, then what about my inheritance? I'll have to give her Elimelech's land and a property of my own also, if children are born to her. Right? So he says, I don't want her. I don't want her. And there we saw. Now this was the custom in the former times of Israel concerning the redemption and exchange of land to confirm any matter. A man removed his sandal and gave it to another, and this was the manner of attestation in Israel. Nice way, right? Okay. Here's my shoe. You give me your shoe. Fine. Matter deal over. Right? Whose shoe is what, but land belongs to me. Imagine if this was happening now. Man. Shoes, everyone is wearing different shoes. This land and that land belongs to me. Okay, so the closest relative said to Boaz, buy it for yourself. And he removed his sandal. Boaz said to the elders, you are witnesses today that I have brought from the hand of Naomi all that belonged to Elimelech and all that belonged to Chilion and Mahalon. I have acquired Ruth the Moabite, the widow of Mahalon, to be my wife in order to raise up a name on his inheritance so that the name of the deceased